Muhammad Ali. Hear someone use boxing and Jews in the same sentence, and odds are you want to chuckle or raise an eyebrow.
Most people have no idea that there were literally thousands of Jewish boxers.
Jewish and boxing don't seem to go together. And yet, here in the States, it was the province, boxing, of every really group, ethnic group, at the bottom of the social staircase. First the Irish, John L. Sullivan's, or James J. Corbett's. Then the second wave of immigration, the Jews. They come in, and they are, within a short period of time, one of the dominant forces that nobody remembers or understands or even goes, huh, in boxing.
If you ask the kid in the Depression, you want to be president of the United States, or do you want to be heavyweight champion of the world? I can tell you right now, they're going to say, oh, I want to be heavyweight champion of the world. I want to be like Jack Dempsey. For Jewish kids, I want to be like Benny Leonard. I want to be like Barney Ross. These were great, great heroes.
Boxing was as much an integral part of the Jewish culture and Jewish immigrant experience as were the urban ghettos they lived in.
I remember one of the studies about the Lower East Side where a scholar had said that there were more people packed into 1 square mile of the Lower East Side than Calcutta.
And many of them were raised in crowded tenements.
When I came to the United States, my mother and I lived with my aunt and uncle. It was a cool flat.
This was the ghetto, and usually both parents worked, and these kids were running around and getting into fights.
I'd fight with other kids. Some people, they say, oh, this guy, oh, he's Jewish. I couldn't take that.
I mean, you're not getting your fighters, if you understand boxing, from the debutante line at the local country club or the Harvard Business School. These are hardscrabble kids.
Well, I like the ghetto. In my days, it was a nice neighborhood, but it was mostly Jewish. I took up boxing in the Settlement House, Henry Street Settlement House. And then, of course, I went to Grant Street Settlement House.
The Settlement Houses were an institution for the Jewish immigrant coming to America. It was a place where they could go and take a class in English, a place where they could go take boxing instruction. It was a way to become more Americanized. Boxers were looked up to. They were the heroes in the neighborhood.
Every 4-round preliminary boxer could make more money in one bout than his sweatshop laboring father or mother could earn in a week.
For young fighters, it was a way to help their families, even though it was difficult because a lot of them were afraid to even to tell their parents. I think the Jewish mother, whose son came in and said, I'm decided to become a boxer, or she found that he's a boxer, I don't know what would be worse, to say that I'm a gangster, you know, I'm working for Murder Incorporated. It was not good. It just was not something that you were anxious to tell a Jewish mom.
Benny Leonard, whose name was not Leonard, it was Lanier, and he changed it to hide from his mother the fact that he was boxing. Until one night he comes home.
My dad came in and he said, look at your face, fighting again for what? I reached in my pocket and brought out a $20 bill and put it in his hand. My dad showed my mother cried, she didn't care about the money. My father turned to me, put the $20 bill into his pocket, pat me on the shoulder and said, Benny, my boy, it's all right. When are you going to fight again?
And Benny boxed and boxed and boxed 221 recorded times. When I wrote Boxing's Greatest Fighters, rating him 1 to 100, I made him number 6 of all time. He was scientific, he was fast, and he had a punch.
He was so fine and so perfect a boxer, and so great defensively that his boast was that he would come out of a 15-round fight with his hair in place.
Benny Leonard had brilliantine hair, which is like Brill Cream. Just slick back. And he prided himself that nobody could muss up his hair. And disaster to those who tried.
They used to say he could call the round, he could call the punch that he knocked people out.
He influenced all those young fighters that came after him. They tried to emulate that style, which was to hit and not be hit.
Now, Benny Leonard retired in 1925, having held the lightweight title for 8 years, longer than any man in history.
During the 1920s and 1930s, almost a third of all professional boxers were Jewish. 20,000 Jews at that time fought for some kind of purse. And between 1910 and 1940, there were 27 Jewish world champions.
Well, in the 1930s, we had Barney Ross.
Barney Ross was another amazing man. He had a rough beginning. The parents moved from New York, Lower East Side. I think he was an infant or very young. And the father opened a store, I think, in the south side of Chicago. And thugs came in the store and murdered his father when he was young. He was a master boxer, tough as nails, almost impossible to knock out. He won the lightweight championship and then the junior welterweight championship. Then he won the welterweight championship. He was a hero on Guadalcanal. He was a credit to the sport of boxing.
The top groupings in every weight class are the Jewish fighters. Lou Temler might have been at the time, and probably up to today, and Manny Pacquiao, the greatest left-handed fighter there ever was.
The editor of Ring magazine, Matt Fleischer, once said that if it wasn't for Benny Leonard boxing at the same time, he says, your father would have definitely been the lightweight champion. My father was born in 1898 in South Philadelphia.
A lot of the Jews didn't even go through Ellis Island that came to Philadelphia. They came through the Port of Philadelphia and they settled in what was known as the Jewish Quarter, which was in South Philadelphia. It was, a bustling area, just like the typical immigrant experience. And it bred tough people because there was a lot of poverty. In order to make money and provide for their families, they were hustlers and they got involved being newsboys.
My father's parents spoke nothing but Hebrew or Jewish, and he needed to help the family. He started selling papers at the age of about 10 till he was 15 years old when he had his first professional fight.
A lot of papers hired sluggers to take over prime corner locations, and the newsboys learned how to fight for their spot.
He had a left hook from hell.
For a few years, he was unbeatable, 5 or 6 years. The people in Philadelphia thought that, you know, he was the best lightweight in the world, which was a hard thing to really say because Benny Leonard was considered the pound for pound, the best fighter in boxing, where they finally got those two together.
Benny Leonard fought Lou Tendler for the lightweight championship in 1923 in front of 65,000 people at Yankee Stadium.
It was the largest gate ever by lightweight. But my dad went up for the weigh-in, and that's when they had this problem there. They both were exactly 134 and a half. That was the weight you had to be. And my father said he kept looking at Leonard, and Leonard looked like a middleweight. He would look powerful.
Lou Tendler almost beat Leonard, but almost ain't good enough.
And years later, they got to be very friendly. He told my father that when he went to he couldn't make the weight. And he said, Lou, I'll tell you right now, if Jack Dempsey got on that scale, he would have weighed 134 pounds. They had the scale set. They couldn't go over if you put an elephant on there.
The Jewish people always were yearning for a Jewish heavyweight champion. I mean, that was because the heavyweight champion, that was the pinnacle. And we thought we had one when Max Baer was heavyweight champion. And he did wear the Jewish star. He wore the Mugen David on his trunks.
My father was Max Baer Sr. He was the 13th heavyweight champion of the world. First time he wore the star, David, was the Schmeling. It was Ansel Hoffman's idea, who was my dad's manager and was Jewish. Ansel Hoffman convinced my father that he was representative of the Jewish people. To be technically Jewish, Orthodox, I guess, your mother has to be Jewish. My father's father was Jewish. His mother was a mixture.
I once asked Ray Arcel, was Max Baer Jewish? He said, no. I said, how did you know? He said, I saw him in the shower.
Ray Arcel supposedly has said that he saw my dad in the shower and my dad wasn't circumcised and that meant he wasn't Jewish. I'm circumcised and I'm a Catholic. So what does it mean? You know, you can kind of ask yourself the question, what was Ray Arcel doing looking at my father's dick?
As far as I know, he was 1/4, I think, Jewish.
I don't know whether he was an 1/8, a quarter, a 1/10, a 1/12. I have no idea. He was Meshuggah, if you want to call it that. That's probably as close to Judaism as he became, as he was Meshuggah.
The years between the First and Second World Wars are often referred to as the Golden Age of Boxing. And during that age, the Jews were at the top of the game.
I remember the pros was tough. But I was a winning fighter. I lost about 2 or 3 fights, maybe 2, but I'll say 3. The first fight I lost, I forgot to duck.
Izzy's one of the last links to the Golden Age. The last main event between two Jewish fighters took place in 1947 at Madison Square Garden between Artie Levine and Herbie Kronowitz.
Artie Levine, big tough boy. And we were good friends too, but it didn't make any difference. When I got in that ring, I'd kill you if I could. Fight went to a decision. I thought I beat him, but they gave it to him. I was the 9th ranking middleweight in the world back in 1945-46. Had 86 pro fights. Always finished on my feet.
I never saw him fight, but I heard he was a very, very tough middleweight.
Herbie was a contender. Today he'd be a world champion.
It was great when you have the fans behind you, they're rooting for you. Especially when you won.
There was no more rabid boxing fan at the time than the Jewish fans.
They would fill ballparks because their fans came out to support them. In fact, sometimes the fights in the stands were as good as the fight in the ring. Never better, almost as.
My father and I were naturally rooting always for the Jewish fighters.
But it's not just the fighters. The boxing world, at a given moment, fighters, managers, trainers, promoters, were Jewish.
Even Braddock had a Jewish manager, Schmeling had a Jewish manager.
If there is any sport that can be described as a, quote, Jewish sport, it is the sport of boxing.